أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and جزاكم الله خير for joining us for day 6 of Little Ramadan Reminders. Today's discussion we'll be talking about the meaning of spirituality or al-ruhaniyya in Islam. Now this topic has existed for as long as essentially human beings have existed. Everybody has spiritual beliefs and everyone claims to be spiritual in one way or another. And this is a very important topic for us as Muslims because there are so many views outside of Islam that are somewhat similar to the view of Islam that often ideas end up becoming introduced into the views of Islam and they have been introduced that inshallah we will understand by the end of this talk. And so it's very important for us as Muslims to be not only very careful to identify how Islam views spirituality or al-ruhaniyya, but also to understand how other beliefs view, or at least views that are similar to ours, that seem to have maybe mingled their way in, to understand what those beliefs are and understand why they may or may not be wrong. Now the first thing to understand is in the Arabic language, the word ar-ruh, while it has many meanings linguistically in the Arabic language, but in this context, it has two meanings that are shared in the same word. The first one is the meaning of the soul, and the second meaning is referring to spirituality. And we will identify these two things. Now the most important thing is to recognize that we're not talking about the soul. When Allah Azza wa says in the Quran, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلَ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي وَمَا أُوتِيتُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. So he says that they ask you about the soul, ar-ruh, so in this context he's talking about the soul, say the soul is a matter for my Lord and you have not been given information about it except very little. And therefore we're not talking about the secret of life, we're not talking about what makes us alive. And the proof that we're not talking about the soul and we're talking about a different type of spirituality is that if you look at, for example, a person who doesn't believe in anything at all, let's say for example Richard Dawkins or somebody really evil like Stalin or Mao or something like that, these people are no less alive. They're still their soul is still fully functional. They still have the secret of life in them and they're not almost on the verge of death. So a person being spiritual or not spiritual has nothing to do with them being alive or dead. Being alive or dead has to do with the soul, and then we're talking about spirituality here. So therefore, in the Arabic language, when we say ar-ruh in this context, we're talking about spirituality, and we're going to try to identify exactly what that means. Now, when we look at what we know about spirituality, we know that everybody essentially, including Muslims, we say that staying away from the dunya and focusing on the akhirah, and this is correct to a very large extent, but it's in the details where the problem occurs. The problem is that what's happened is we've taken so for example, we know of narrations when Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was dipping some bread into some oil and then he was dipping into some vinegar and he was about to eat it, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, oh Ali, don't waste. So we know that the Sahaba lived very simple lives, although some of them were extremely wealthy, but they lived very simple lives and they did not allow the dunya to take their focus away from the akhirah. And therefore when this lifestyle was introduced almost when, you know, during later centuries, Muslims began becoming introduced to more beliefs and Greek philosophy and so on. So certain ideas began, because they look so similar, they ended up affecting our viewpoint. And so we started saying that the dunya is a material thing and we should stay away from material things and we should focus on spiritual things. But the problem with this idea of material and spiritual, and that they're two separate things and that we should focus on the spiritual, this actually does not come from Islam. Interestingly enough, it actually comes from Christianity. In Christianity, there's this concept called the dichotomy between matter and spirit. And what it means, when you have a dichotomy, you have two ends of a scale, and you cannot share any qualities on two ends. If you go towards one end, you lose everything from the other end, an equal amount. So if you are 70% worldly or dunya, then you have 30% spiritual left in you. So you've abandoned 70% of the spiritual. If you have 100% spiritual, you would have abandoned everything. That's why you find, for example, priests, monks and so on, they'll abandon everything. They'll abandon all wealth, they'll wear, you know, burlap, they won't get married. They'll stay away from the whole world. You know, as they say, they dedicate themselves to God. Same thing with nuns and so on. And so this idea, you know, hermits and so on. So this idea of this world, essentially from the view of Christianity, the world, that essentially God created the world with a spiritual realm and a material realm. And it's a struggle between those two sides, and it's up to us to decide which side we want to be on. Do we want to be a spiritual person or a material person? As for the view of Islam, we know of many ayat and ahadith that give us hints as to the correct Islamic viewpoint, such as وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا, don't forget your portion of the dunya. So is Allah telling us to stay away from spiritual things and take some of the worldly things and abandon some of us, be less spiritual people? The answer is obviously not. And to understand Islamic viewpoint, I'll give you a few examples to introduce the idea. If a person goes to pray salah, and we all know that's a quote-unquote spiritual action. Now, if a person goes to pray salah, but he's doing it because he wants to impress his parents, he doesn't really believe in this, but he wants his whole family's praying, and he just wants to be a part of this nice gathering, or he wants them to think of him as being a spiritual person. Is this a spiritual action? And of course, we know the answer is no. This is a purely material action. If a lady is going out and it's raining outside, so she puts a scarf over her head, does that mean she's wearing hijab? Is that a spiritual act? And again, no. She's just trying to cover her hair from the rain. Therefore, it's a material act. Now, if a person, for example, you're going to do business where people usually think of buying and selling as something that's not very spiritual. But if you're going to conduct your business according to the Quran and Sunnah, and your intention is with Allah Azza wa Jalla to be good, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Al-Tajir al-Sadiq al-Amin ma'al-Anbiya wa shuhada wa al-Siddiqeen. The tradesman who is truthful and trustworthy is with the prophets and the shuhada and the martyrs and the Siddiqeen, those who accept the truth instantly without hesitation. And so when we look at conducting business in an honest and trustworthy way and a truthful way, with having that intention to obey this hadith and hopefully be amongst the prophets and the shuhada and the siddiqeen, so this makes buying and selling suddenly a spiritual act. And a person can spend his whole day doing business and buying and selling and keep continuing his intention of trying to please Allah Azza wa Jal, letting some things go, making sure that he does things very nice. Rasulullah Hassan mentions that there's quite a few hadith that talk about how the best of us are the ones who are forgiving in business transactions. So he allows certain things to slide, he lets the guy have a little bit extra, and so on and so forth. He's doing all these things with the intention of trying to please Allah Azza wa Jal. That makes all of these business transactions spiritual. And the same thing of just sitting and socializing, sitting with brothers and laughing and joking and having fun, within a certain limit, of course, not all the time. But when you do these things, this is actually a sunnah, to sit and eat and have fun with the brothers and so on. And the same thing for the sisters among themselves. And so and of course, the separation between the men and the women. And so by organizing things in this way and having the right intention, one makes his life spiritual from every angle. And this is what it goes down to, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Actions are according to intentions. Actions are defined by the intentions, and for each person what he intended. And so therefore an action becomes spiritual based on the intention. And therefore the view of Islam is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the whole entire world from matter. The whole world is made of material. Angels, people always consider angels a spiritual realm or something. No, angels are material. They're made from light. Jinn are material. They're made from a smokeless fire. Human beings are material. We're made from mud or clay. We're all made from things in this world. Light and everything else in this world are material. And therefore, in order for anything material to become spiritual, is when you organize that object that is created according to the instructions, the commands and prohibitions of the Creator. So once you identify that something is created by the world is created by a creator, then you have the opportunity to be spiritual. And then once you act based on that and you connect an action to pleasing the creator subhanahu wa ta'ala, then your action becomes spiritual. And this is how Allah Azza wa Jal has blessed us essentially with Islam, because as we discussed in previous halqat, that Allah Azza wa Jal has revealed Islam as a clarification for all things. And so Islam is a complete and comprehensive system for all areas of life. And that means, in this context of spirituality, every single thing that we do in our entire life, from the moment we wake up until the moment we go to sleep, from the moment we reach puberty essentially until we pass away, everything we do can be a spiritual action which fills our life with spirituality, no matter what we're doing. Whether we're just sitting, whether we're eating, whether we're walking, whether we're driving, meeting people, working, reading the news, analyzing the problems in the Muslim world, working towards changing the Muslim world. Politics, where people say, oh, politics is material, stay away from politics, do spiritual things. This is completely false. This idea that secularism has come in, secularism has introduced into our lives, where spiritual things are only in the home, and they're only in the mosque, and they're only within your individual actions, and they don't belong in society, this is completely false. Islam says that everything in life can be spiritual, because everything in life, just like your home was created by Allah Azza wa Jal, and the masjid was created by Allah Azza wa Jal, and you were created by Allah Azza wa Jal, society was created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Systems of government were created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Economic systems were created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So organizing our individual acts of worship by the commands and prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is equally spiritual to organizing our economic matters by the commands and prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our ruling structure by the commands and prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our immigration laws by the commands and prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how everything becomes spiritual in the world. And this is why it's so important to have an Islamic way of life under an Islamic society. And of course, this is why we need a khilafah, so that we can live the Islamic way of life, so we can live a spiritual life in all walks of life, instead of being at home and having a spiritual atmosphere, and then once you walk outside, it's all thrown away into the wind. You don't see anything organized by the commands and prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're told that God does not belong. Spirituality does not belong in society. Spirituality has no place when formulating societal laws. This is what secularism teaches. And this is one of the worst things that has happened to this ummah, is we've accepted this secularization of spirituality, and it must be rejected, and it must be changed. Spirituality is when we organize everything in life according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided us. It creates a world that is managed properly, because it's managed by the designer of the world, and it creates a sense of spirituality within our hearts by giving us the tranquility we find in salah. We also find it in everything else that we do. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this adds clarity to the topic, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rid us of this corruption, of this idea of separation of spirituality from life. And may Allah Azza wa Jalla make our lives full of spirituality. And Jazakumullah khair for joining us. And inshallah, we'll see you tomorrow for day 7. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.